All right, guys, how's it going? This week's tech news has been dominated by the return of GameWorks, with a whole slew of GameWorks technologies being implemented in Square Enix's upcoming Final Fantasy XV. And rather predictably, the benchmarks show the problem. As we can see here over at Computer Base, the difference between the standard quality, where even though Vega is falling slightly behind where it would normally be, it's once you move to the high quality and the full GameWorks settings, which incidentally cannot be disabled, we now see crushing victories for the Nvidia cards. And in this one over at Game GPU, we see even the RX Vega 64 falling behind the GTX 1060. But rather than simply go over the tests and benchmarks, which plenty of others have done previously, I decided to take a look back at the history of cheating and lying in benchmarks. And as you'll soon see, it's not just Nvidia who's been up to this nonsense historically. Far from it, in fact. So we're heading way back to the tail end of 2001 over at Hard OCP and the author, Kyle Bennett, who asked the question if ATI were optimizing or cheating with their Radeon 8500 drivers. And this all started out with a game that, back then at least, everybody was very familiar with, Quake 3 Arena. And it was not only a staple to many online gamers, it was also the de facto 3D benchmark in the world at that time. And the crux of the issue here was, ATI had written their driver to identify when Quake 3 Arena was running, and then optimise their driver to give better frame rates when benchmarking and playing the game. Now today you might think, well, what's wrong with that? Surely this is what happens all the time. But back then, many people frowned upon this type of optimization. As Kyle explains, is it wrong for ATI to deliver drivers that give better frame rates in a specific application? Or should they be optimizing for the game engine instead? And with pretty solid reasoning saying that, there are certainly other games out there based on the Quake 3 engine that could also benefit from these optimizations. Now the issue was discovered back in their original Radeon 8500 review, and with a little program known as the Quackifier. A pretty simple program which basically just modified the Quake 3 binary and changed all string values Quake into Quack, before creating a new executable called Quack3.exe. Now the point of this would be, of course, with the ATI drivers now specifically looking for the Quake 3 binary, and with that binary now being renamed to Quack3 instead, the driver optimizations would not work. And now looking at the results, if you just concentrate on this blue bar and the cyan bar here, this first result of 136 frames per second at 720p was the result with the proper Quake 3 executable. With the Quack 3 executable, the frame rate had dropped to 115, a difference of 18%, simply by modifying the name of the executable. And a bunch of readers of HardOCP had also decided to join in this, discovering explicit references to Quake 3 in ATI's OpenGL driver. And HardOCP's conclusion was, the facts as they see them, ATI has in fact included application-specific instructions that make Quake 3 Arena benchmarks faster by up to over 15%. But the real question here is, does this really make any difference? Does it matter that ATI explicitly targeted Quake 3 Arena for performance optimizations? Surely free performance in any case is a good thing, and at least today everybody would agree with that. The problem in this case though, was it wasn't really free performance. As was noted over at websites such as 3D Center, The Tech Report, and Firing Squad, this extra performance came with a rather severe drawback. And over at 3D Center we can see, first of all, a screenshot taken with the Nvidia GeForce 2 Ultra, and then below that, the ATI Radeon 8500. Now you may actually notice here that the 8500 does appear to have a sharper image, and more vibrant colours, but a bit more about that later. But what's really interesting is what happens to the 8500's image quality when the driver optimizations are included, and simply mousing over the image shows a very clear drop in quality. It's pretty dramatic, and the quality is now far worse than the GeForce 2 Ultra. Now on the left here we have Nvidia again, the GeForce 2 Ultra, and on the right again we have the Radeon 8500 before optimizations. Again you might look at that and say the ATI card does look like it has a clearer image, sharper, it's more defined, but when you mouse over the image, we now see the dramatic difference in quality with the driver optimization. Moving over to the Tech Report's evidence, and here we can see what the game is meant to look like at the highest settings, but now with the driver optimizations, we can clearly see a dramatic loss in texture quality. The Tech Report's article goes into some extra depth, it is well worth checking this one out. There will of course be a link in the video description. As mentioned, Firing Squad also got in on the act, however some of these are pretty old articles and you can't always get hold of the images any longer. But a more revealing article over at Firing Squad was how ATI responded. And speaking to David Nalani Velasco, back then the technology marketing manager for ATI, and who incidentally is still at the Radeon Technologies Group, Firing Squad first of all asked him to describe the history of these drivers and how they came about. And David responded that these drivers are the first publicly released drivers that take advantage of the unique new capabilities of the Radeon 8500. Firing Squad then asked further questions along the lines of, will ATI next release benchmark specific enhancements? And will ATI continue to release game specific enhancements, and will they be undocumented? To which David responded that, as a general rule, they do not comment on specific driver optimizations for competitive reasons. Continuing with, when we start optimizing our drivers for specific applications, we have to make a judgment call as to which games we think are most important and what combination of factors will contribute to the best experience for that game. There are many ways to do this, but one way is to look at how the product gets evaluated in media reviews. And then bizarrely continues with, one look at the graphics card reviews that have appeared over the past several months will show that Quake 3 frame rates, not image quality, interestingly, have been one of the most commonly used means of judging the relative goodness of a product. And if this metric really wasn't considered important to users, then you have to ask the question, why have reviewers given it so much attention? Essentially, David back then was saying that because frame rates are more important in Quake, then drivers should be optimized to improve the frame rate, especially as nobody was talking about image quality. Of course, in most games, there is another way to increase frame rate, and that's by dropping the settings, which funnily enough also tend to reduce image quality. So I'm not entirely sure I'm buying this excuse. But over the page, Firing Squad continued with, one of the chief complaints readers have with the new drivers is that they can't be disabled. To which David replied, most of our optimizations for Quake 3 and other applications have no impact at all on image quality, and therefore it would be pointless to allow users to disable them. Before continuing, it is also important to note that the image quality obtained using all of the standard image settings in Quake 3, that is fastest, fast, normal, and high quality, can be observed to be equal to or better than any competing product. And in the case of Quake 3 Arena, it is only in the special case of selecting high quality and turning the texture quality slider up to the highest setting that a potential discrepancy appears. Another way of saying this would be highest settings, which as we all know tend to be how games are benchmarked. But looking back at what I showed earlier, I think it's fair to say that the ATI cards did have slightly better image quality than the Nvidia cards, or at least the Nvidia 2 Ultra. However, I think it's safe to say in this case, ATI's method of regaining some lost frame rate is simply not legitimate. For now, I'm going with ATI being guilty. Fast forward a year and a half, and a great article by Dave Salvatore over at Extreme Tech, driver irregularities may inflate Nvidia benchmarks. Which starts off with, in our recent GeForce FX 5900 Ultra story, we noticed the Nvidia board was well ahead of ATI's Radeon 9800 Pro and FutureMark's 3D Mark 2003 benchmark, but the two boards were much more evenly matched in our GameGauge application benchmark suite. Now, Extreme Tech's GameGauge suite tests with 8 real games, while FutureMark's benchmark uses 4 synthetic games, and Extreme Tech's test results seem to indicate that Nvidia was boosting its 3D Mark game test scores by cutting corners in the 44.03 Detonator FX drivers. Now, Dave goes on to explain that 3D Mark's 4 game tests are deterministic, meaning they do the exact same thing every time. And this is generally what benchmarks should do. They need to be repeatable and comparable. The problem with that, though, is because a given workload is identical from run to run, hardware vendors can carefully study it and make optimizations to maximize performance, some of which could be legitimate and others unsavory. In these types of deterministic tests, the camera movement is essentially on a rail. Think of the opening credit sequence in Half-Life, where you ride the tram into the depths of the base. But because the camera's every move is a known quantity, hardware vendors are able to figure out exactly what will and won't be visible to the camera. And this is where they can look for places to cut corners. But this is where it gets interesting, because there was a developer version of 3D Mark 03, version 3.2, which allowed the tester to pause playback and then move freely through the scene. But Nvidia, because they were not a member of FutureMark's beta program, did not have access to that developer version when testing the 5900 Ultra with 3D Mark 2003. And during Extreme Tech's testing of 3D Mark, they paused the benchmark, went into free look mode, and moved off the rail in the 3D scene. And once they did, serious drawing errors were readily apparent. Over at the Tech Report again, something I found very interesting. Scott Wasson again having a real go at NVIDIA. And he said, these revelations, however, do not surprise us in any grand way. NVIDIA has always been, top to bottom, ambitious to a fault. Intentional deception of the press, the enthusiast community, add-in board partners, consumers and shareholders with these kinds of tricks is nothing less than what we'd expect from the company. Just over 1 week later, FutureMark Corporation launched their audit report on alleged NVIDIA driver cheating on 3D Mark 03. And FutureMark discovered that certain NVIDIA products had a performance drop of as much as 24.1%, with their detonator driver no longer able to detect the benchmark. So FutureMark's further investigation found that certain NVIDIA drivers seemed to detect when 3D Mark 03 was running, and then replaced the application's rendering requests with manually implemented alternative rendering operations. And these alternative operations reduced the amount of rendering work and thereby increased the obtained benchmark result. And once again, it was found that these driver cheats increased benchmark performance at the expense of image quality. And not only did FutureMark find one or two problems, there were in fact multiple issues. A total of 8 changes to the benchmark, mostly revolving around failing to clear the back buffer and adding static clipping planes. And at the end of the document, we can see the results. Up at the top here, Game Test 4, we can quite clearly see it is not rendering properly because of clip planes and a failure to clear the buffer. This is how it should look. And once again on Game Test 2, we can clearly see that the buffers are not being cleared. And this is how it looks when the demo is properly rendered. Not clearing the buffers would save on bandwidth, allowing for that to be used elsewhere. Now, when FutureMark were asked if this was just them taking revenge on NVIDIA for leaving the beta program, they said no, that their business relies on their ability to produce unbiased benchmarks that enable apples-to-apples comparisons. And any company that deliberately tries to fool our products is actually trying to take an advantage of our credibility, and they will not tolerate such actions from anyone. Some pretty strong words there from FutureMark. However, only 3 days later, Patrick Ojala, the producer of 3D Mark, said over at the Beyond 3D forum, "I'm doing my best to keep the next 3D Mark on track despite this PR mess, but it's not easy. We are a small company, 26 employees total, in Finland, and a 3-person sales office in the US. But perhaps more tellingly, they have no desire to confront a huge 1,500 employee market leader of high-end PC graphics," talking about NVIDIA, who have got many more employees today, of course. But Patrick wishes that he could somehow leave behind their differences in opinions, again work together on a new 3D Mark version, and again do their best to make it reflect the future of 3D game performance. Just over a week later, FutureMark come out and say, "Nah, NVIDIA didn't really cheat at all." Here over at the Register, we find that FutureMark now had a deeper understanding of the situation and NVIDIA's optimization strategy. And in light of this, FutureMark now states that NVIDIA's driver design is an application-specific optimization and not a cheat. And the Register finishes with, "In the meantime, its statement will be unlikely to impress users who've seen screenshots showing the effects of NVIDIA's optimized shaders." For me, I simply remember this as the day FutureMark sold their souls to the devil. NVIDIA, just like ATI 18 months before, absolutely guilty as sin. So all of that would have been a great chance for ATI to reclaim some of the respect they lost during the Quack fiasco. But it turns out in 3D Mark, ATI were also up to no good. They gained a couple of percent performance in one of 3D Mark's tests. And while they were keen to point out that they rendered the scene exactly as intended by FutureMark, in full precision floating point, they also recognised that these can be used by some people to call into question the legitimacy of benchmark results. And they chose to remove this optimization in their next Catalyst driver release. There's no question that today ATI optimizations here would be seen as completely legitimate, and what they did in 3D Mark 03 was nowhere near as bad as what NVIDIA did, but they could really have taken the high road at this point had they not done this. With all these new methods of cheat detection out in the open, it came as no surprise to find that NVIDIA was also caught cheating in 3D Mark 2001, when Unwinder, the developer of the Riva Tuner application, discovered a massive difference in Game 4 Nature benchmark. And a few days later, even fewer were surprised to see that ATI 2 cheated in 3D Mark 2001 in the exact same benchmark. But after this explosion of cheating and being caught, it appeared that both companies had learned their lesson, with no major incidents, at least no major incidents detected, for another 7 years. We're over at NVIDIA.com's blogs back in November 19th, 2010, and Nick Stamm, writing this blog to bring broader attention to some very important image quality findings, uncovered recently by top technology websites including Computer Base, PC Games Hardware, Tweak PC, and 3dcenter.org. Now, there were a couple of issues raised here by Nick, and the first one was on AMD's anisotropic filtering. And here in the game Trackmania, we can see an example of where it's going wrong. On the left we have Nvidia, and on the right we have AMD. And zooming in, looking along this line here, we can see a clear flaw in AMD's implementation. And this is with a still image. This would look even worse in motion. So this was the first issue that Nvidia had. However, this was something AMD had fixed at a hardware level with their HD 6000 series cards. And over at Anantech, we can see the problem. When we compare the HD 5870 to the HD 6870, and finally the GeForce GTX 480. The last two are pretty similar in quality, but there's a clear problem there with the HD 5870's filtering. So the first issue at least was seemingly fixed. The second issue Nvidia had was with AMD's rendering of FP16, where Nick says, "For months AMD has been performing a background optimization for certain DX9 applications where FP16 render targets are demoted to R11 G11 B10 render targets, which are half the size and less accurate." Over at the PC magazine Atomic, they decided to take a much closer look at this, unearthing one or two revelations in the process. First of all, they discovered that Nvidia's reviewer's guide claimed that AMD had admitted that performance optimization in their driver alters image quality in the above applications, those being Dawn of War 2, Empire Total War, Need for Speed Shift, Oblivion Series Sam 2, and Far Cry 1. And as just discussed, the specific change involves demoting FP16 render targets to R11 G11 B10 render targets, which are half the size and less accurate. And Nvidia then recommend that the correct way to benchmark these applications is by disabling Catalyst AI in AMD's control panel. Now, undoubtedly, most of you are wondering, what is this FP16 demotion all about? And essentially, it comes down to a change in how HDR lighting is calculated. This R11 G11 B10 means that the red and green channels have 11 bits each, and you guessed it, the blue one has 10. The end result of this is halving the size of the frame buffer, cutting the amount of memory demanded by the HDR lighting engine by 50%, and Nvidia is clearly unhappy about AMD doing this. However, in Nvidia's technical brief, Microsoft DirectX 10, the next generation graphics API, and over at page 11, we see that DirectX 10 introduces two new HDR formats that offer the same dynamic range as FP16, but at half the storage. And the first format you've just met, R11 G11 B10. There is also a second floating point format known as RGBE, and the paragraph ends by claiming that these new formats allow high dynamic range rendering without the high storage and bandwidth costs. So this was AMD's defense. Given that in their own documents, Nvidia indicates that R11 G11 B10 format offers the same dynamic range as FP16 but at half the storage, it would appear to us that our competitor shares the conviction that it's an acceptable alternative. But what really matters, again, is the actual quality of the output. Atomic discovered that demotion doesn't affect all games in the same way. And their conclusion was, they've seen 4 games so far and only one presented an obvious change, which was Far Cry. However, on the other side of the coin were the performance improvements, which were plentiful in 2 games of the 4, boosting performance by 17% at higher resolution. So in this case of the FP16 demotion, it truly did look like a case of sacrificing very small amounts of image quality for a very large gain in frame rate. Certainly nothing like what we saw before with Quake, where we saw clear evidence of a dramatic drop in texture quality. But with that said, you have to look at Nvidia's argument and say, there is a difference there. It is not completely apples to apples, but even if you look at the old Quake, it never was truly apples to apples. ATI had slightly better image quality before they started messing around, trying to get higher frame rate. But getting back to Nick Stam's blog, we have had internal discussions as to whether we should forgo our position to not reduce image quality behind your back as AMD is doing, and that they believe their customers would rather Nvidia focuses their resources to maximize performance and provide an awesome immersive gaming experience without compromising image quality than engage in a race to the IQ gutter with AMD. So a pretty harsh conclusion there, and the gloves were off again. Not even 2 weeks later, AMD are back bashing Nvidia over alleged Hawks anti-aliasing cheats. And Nick was rolled out once again to address their cheating allegations, going on to say that what is being experienced is not an anti-aliasing cheat, but rather a Hawks bug that is fixed by our driver using an application-specific profile. By this point, I'd pretty much switched off to all of it, as it was pretty clear to me that both sides were just as bad as each other. But getting back to the present, and over at Gamers Nexus, Steve's article on Final 15's misleading benchmark, improper GameWorks object culling, the difference between the history that you just watched and today is that back then, both of these companies attempted to gain frame rate by lowering image quality. But ever since, really, Nvidia bought out Aegea and acquired PhysX through that, Nvidia sort of changed the rules of the game by giving having higher image quality, which came at a worsening frame rate cost. It just so happens that the frame rate cost is a lot worse on the AMD graphics cards, and we saw this in the computer base and game GPU benchmarks earlier. So this is how Nvidia now cheats, for want of a better word. And in Gamers Nexus article, they say that the benchmark is rendering creatures that use hairworks even when they're miles away from the character and the camera. And more tellingly, again, this was made evident while running benchmarks in a zone with no hairworks whatsoever, zero, none, at which point they realized by accessing the game setting files that disabling hairworks would still improve performance even when no hairworks objects were on the screen. And here we see high quality fur from a distance of 10,000 feet, and of course using GameWorks massive over tessellation. And Gamers Nexus found that the cows, the buffalo, whatever, are being rendered at all times during the benchmark. Now this is a great article over at Gamers Nexus, by all means check it out if you haven't done already. It is 90% Square Enix's fault. Nvidia still has to take blame simply for the existence of GameWorks, but even with Nvidia's blame, I still blame the Radeon Technologies Group. The fact of the matter is, they have had years to put this one to bed. Physics is how old now? They never really truly dealt with that problem, and now GameWorks has been around for years and they have never properly dealt with this problem. Polaris brought in the primitive discard accelerator, but it's clearly not discarding enough. And of course they made all of their own stuff, TressFX, that kind of thing. That was all made open source and freely downloadable and usable by game developers. But you have to ask the question, what did that achieve? How often has that been used? Why would the Final Fantasy XV developers choose GameWorks instead? We recently learned that the Radeon Technologies Group has new leadership, and with that brings the possibility of a new challenge to Nvidia in gaming. But no matter how good the hardware is, if AMD do not deal with GameWorks once and for all, they will always be open to this kind of problem. The fact is, Nvidia has enough money these days to buy every single developer out there, and in the slight chance that the Radeon Technologies Group ever gets their hardware fast enough again, then it should be clear that Nvidia has other options of slowing down their competitors' performance. That's me for this one. It's always great taking a look back at the history and how things have evolved, but there's also no question that ATI gave as good as they got, but since AMD bought them over, they're just a shadow of themselves. They need to find a way to get this GameWorks monkey off their back, and if they're not able to deal with Nvidia, then maybe they need to find ways to deal with the developers or the publishers instead. But I'm done with this one. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Check out all my links in the description below, including my Amazon links, and I'll catch you later, guys.